Buenos días, buenas tardes o buenas noches. Yo soy el profesor Boina y hoy vamos a atacar, explorar, estudiar el capítulo 1 en su texto Dos Mundos. La primera parte del capítulo 1 tiene que ver con los números de 100 a 1000 y más de 1000 y fechas y cómo se expresan en español. Como ustedes ven en su libro, el número 100 es simplemente el número 100. Pero cuando le ponemos más números, tenemos 110, 120, 130, 140, etc. Luego pasamos a 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 800, 900 y finalmente 1000. 1000. Un concepto muy importante en español. Once you get up to 200 or more, the things you're counting, we have to use the correct form of the number, just as if it were an adjective. We have 200, we also have 200. So if you're talking about 200 books, that's easy. It's still 200 libros. $200. Dólares happens to be masculine. We have 200 dólares. 200 euros. 200 pesos. It's masculine. However, if you're saying they're building 200 houses, then you cannot use 200. This has to match. So you're going to use 200. 200 casas, 200 personas, 200 chicas, etcétera, etcétera, etcétera. Muy bien, el otro concepto en español es en las fechas. En inglés we use 1990, en español no. The year is 1990, it's the year 1990. So I have to use 1000, 900, and the number 90. There's no either. 1990. So if we happen to be in the year 2011, I have 2000, 2011. If you were born in 1992, por ejemplo, you would say yo nací en 1992. If the year is 1865, then it's 1865. Muy bien. Muy bien. The second concept, the second part of capítulo 1, is probably the second most important lesson you've had up to this point. The first important, most important lesson you've had up to this point was, as I mentioned earlier, in paso C, el verbo hablar and how to conjugate or break down AR verbs. The largest group of verbs in Espanol are the AR verbs. El verbo hablar. As you recall, we broke that into our five subjects. In this case, hablo, I speak. Hablas, you speak tú. Habla, el, ella, usted. If you're with another person, hablamos. If you're talking about two or more people, or talking to two or more people, habla. So, those endings, o, as, a, amos, an, are going to be crucial. And you're going to see them in another slightly variated form in the next section. El verbo leer, you notice one thing, it doesn't end in AR, it ends in ER. El verbo vivir ends in IR. As I mentioned previously, these are the only three groups of verbs in the entire Spanish language. Every single verb in the infinitive or basic form is going to end in AR, ER, or IR. Muy bien. So, just as I said, hablo, for I speak, dropping the AR and adding the O, leer, meaning to read, to say I read, I drop the ER and add, surprisingly, an O. Leo. I read, yo leo. Now, slightly different for tú, but the S is there. You read, Nace. Nace. He or she, Ne. Nosotros, Neemos. Ellos, Ne. Look at the commonalities. O, O. We have an S here. We have an S here. We drop the S to get to the third person. Ne habla. M-O-S. Hablamos, leemos. Notice that the A, hablar, hablamos. Leer, leemos. And to make it plural, to talk about two or more people, or talk to two or more people, we still have the letter N. In this case, it's E-N. Leo, leis, ne, leemos, ne. This is the second conjugation, ER verbs, and there are hundreds of them. Vivir, to live. To say I live, surprisingly, not surprisingly, keep the stem, add the O. Vivo, vivo en Las Vegas, vivo en Ventura, vivo en Oxnard. Tú vives, just like the ER. Ella, or él, o usted, vive. ¿Dónde vive usted? Where do you live? Again, there's just no S to make it plural. The nosotros form takes this vowel. Vivimos. We live. We live. Vivimos. Y ellos viven. They live. Note that between the ER and IR verbs, ER y IR, hay solamente una diferencia. Nosotros vivimos. Leemos, la única diferencia. And it's consistent because AR, hablar, hablamos. Leer, leemos. Vivir, vivimos. Again, as I mentioned, these are your multiplication tables. These are the patterns that you have to practice over and over and commit to memory and practice and practice and practice. Again, these are the basic things. If you don't have this down at a certain point, you're not going to be able to move on to the other issues that we have with the language. So, this is your fundamental, this is your mission, this is your quest, this is your holy grail. Muy bien, ejercicio dos, número uno. They want to use the correct form of the verb leer, according to the subject. This is very similar to what we did in paso C with the verb hablar. So we're given a subject, which is número uno, muchos españoles. Many Spaniards, many Spanish people. Muchos españoles en el periódico El País. So many Spanish people read the newspaper called El País. Now, many Spanish people, it's not I, it's not you, it's not he or she. Unless you're there with them, it can't be nosotros. So I need to use this form of the verb to fill in the blank, which in this case is going to be E-N-N-A. Muy bien, continue on. Siga. Ejercicio 3 is the same as ejercicio 2, but with the verb vivir. I need to choose the correct form. Número 1 dice Pablo blank en Texas. Pablo en Texas. Pablo, not yo, not tú, could be he, nosotros no, ellos no. So, singular, one person, I'm talking about Pablo. I need to choose the third person singular. Vive, vive. Muy bien. So when I refer to first person, second person, third person, first person, primera persona, I'm referring to yo in the singular, nosotros in the plural. Segunda persona, second person, is going to be tú. Tercera persona, third person, is going to be he, she, or you, usted. And ellos, ellas, ustedes. Singular, plural. Singular, plural. Muy bien. Muy bien. Sección 1.3. How do we form questions in Spanish and how do we use question words correctly? We've already had a bunch of questions, right? ¿Cómo te llamas? ¿Cómo te llamas? ¿Dónde vives? ¿Cómo estás? But these are question words which begin with an interrogative. ¿Cómo? ¿Dónde? We have other ones like ¿cuándo? As in when. ¿Cuándo es tu cumpleaños? We have that question in class. ¿When is your birthday? ¿Cuándo es? Etc. Now, in this case, we have the interrogative word that helps us get the question started. But in, often in Spanish, you don't have, just like in English, we don't have necessarily an interrogative verb. We just want to ask, for example, as it says in your book, is Esteban young? Is he a young guy? In this case, we just start with the verb. Es joven Esteban? Es joven Esteban? Es viejo Don Eduardo? So I put my verb at the beginning, my adjective followed by the subject. As opposed to, if I want to say Don Eduardo is old, Don Eduardo es viejo, it's my normal form for a declarative statement. Don Eduardo is my subject, es is my verb, viejo is my adjective, it's describing him. Don Eduardo es viejo, Carmen es simpática, el profesor es joven, etc., etc., etc. But if I want to make it a question, I start with the verb instead. Es viejo Don Eduardo, es joven Esteban, etc. Muy bien. En ejercicio 4, number 1, you're given a statement, you have to turn it into a question. Number 1 states, Ernesto y Esteban están casados. Ernesto and Esteban are married. So now I want to ask, are they married, Ernesto and Esteban? So I put the verb at the beginning. Están casados Ernesto y Esteban. Están casados. So again, I reverse it. I put the verb first. Second one. Clarisa y Marisa son inteligentes. Clarisa and Marisa are smart. So, I want to form a question. I start with the verb again, followed by the adjective. Son inteligentes. Clarisa y Marisa. Muy bien. Continue on with that pattern. Muy bien. Ejercicio 5 gives you a statement. You need to choose the correct logical interrogative word to start a question. So, you're given a statement, por ejemplo, Amanda tiene 14 años. Amanda is 14 years old. Logically, the question that would elicit that response, just like in Jeopardy, is how old is Amanda? Which we know in Spanish, we don't say how old is someone, we say how many years do they have. And so you're given the question, ¿cuántos años tiene Amanda? ¿Cuántos años tiene? That answers the question that is given to you. Amanda tiene 14 años. Now, this cuántos, for how many, has to agree with the thing you're counting. So, cuántos años is correct because años happens to be masculino, plural. ¿Cuántos años? But you want to say, how many homework assignments do you normally have? It's tareas, so I have to match the right form of cuantos to tareas. I can't use cuantos, I have to say cuantas tareas, for how many. If I'm talking about money, dinero, and I'm asking someone, hey dude, how much money do you have? I can't use cuantos or cuantas because that's how much, that's how many. I want to know how much, so I have to use cuanto. ¿Cuánto dinero tienes? ¿Cuánto cuesta? How much does it cost? Etc, etc, etc. Muy bien. So let's see if we can choose the correct question verb para número uno. Dice, Rubén Hernández vive en Florida. Rubén Hernández lives in Florida. Is that a cómo? How? Question? ¿Dónde? Where? ¿Qué? What? ¿Cuándo? When? ¿Por cuántos? ¿O cuánto? Rubén Hernández vive en Florida. Logically, I want to ask, where does he live? And my question word is, ¿dónde? ¿Dónde vive Rubén Hernández? Nothing else changes. ¿Dónde? Muy bien. Muy bien. Telling time. Telling time in español. Muy fácil. Muy fácil. Hay dos preguntas muy importantes. Dos preguntas. ¿Qué hora es? ¿Y a qué que hora es? If you want to know the time, simply, que hora es? If you want to know at what time something is happening, as in the concert, the class, the party, etc., a que hora es? Muy bien, your answers. Que hora es? Are normally going to end with son. Son las 3:20. Son las 3:20. The exception is for 1 o'clock. Since one is singular, if it happens to be 1 o'clock, then it is la una. Beyond that, son las dos, son las tres, son las cuatro, son las cinco. There are a little trickiness when it comes to past the half hour. Por ejemplo, ¿qué hora es? Two ways to say it, actually more than two. Son las 3:40. No problem. 3:40. Pero, you can also subtract. You can go back. You can say it's 4:20. Son las 4:20. More and more, you young people out there prefer 3:40 because you don't know how to tell time on a real clock. I'm just kidding, some of you do. Big hands and little hands. But in the digital age, more and more people are saying 3:40, 3:45. When you have a quarter of an hour, you have a cuarto. So if it happens to be 2:15, son las 2:15. Not to be confused with the number 4, cuatro. Son las 2:15. Son las 2:15. Las 2:15. And so if you have a quarter till, such as 3:45, 3:45 is also son las 4:15. 4:15, literally 4:15, or quarter till 4, we used to say back in the day. Muy bien, 4:15. If you have a half hour, you have media, or 30. Son las 3:30. Nothing wrong with saying son las 3:30. 3:30, 3:30, 4:30, etc. Muy bien. And so if you have class at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and someone says to you, ¿a qué hora es tu clase? ¿A qué hora? ¿A qué hora es tu clase de matemáticas? And your class is at 2, you would say, mi clase es a las 2. A las dos, at 2, as opposed to son las dos, which means it's 2 o'clock right now. A las dos, at 2. What if your class meets at noon? A mediodía. A mediodía. Mediodía, as in buenos días, masculino, mediodía. If your class meets at midnight, your parents actually might believe that, I doubt it, it'd be a media noche. A medianoche, a medianoche, a mediodía, at noon, a medianoche, at midnight. Muy bien. Muy bien. A recurring theme in our lessons in Espanol is that Spanish and English accomplish different communicative tasks in different ways. Early on, we had the question, ¿cómo te llamas? ¿Cómo te llamas? Now, we ask this question when we want to know someone's name, but as we learned, ¿cómo te llamas? Does not literally mean word for word, what is your name? It literally means, how do you call yourself? And of course, our answer was, me llamo Alfredo, me llamo María, etc. ¿Cómo te llamas? Likewise, in Espanol, when you talk about things that you like, you don't literally say, I like this, or I like to do that, etc., etc., etc. In Espanol, we use the verb gustar and there are other verbs like it as well down the road, to say something is pleasing to us. So we don't have a subject, I like chocolate. Literally, the tail wags the dog. We say chocolate is pleasing to me. But how do we say that? El chocolate is going to be over here. We say, me gusta. Me gusta el chocolate. Literally, chocolate, it pleases. Remember the third person ending? Ah, it's an habla. Me gusta el chocolate. Me gusta. The subject of the sentence actually is chocolate. Because chocolate does the action. Chocolate pleases me. Chocolate pleases me. Me gusta el chocolate. Comer frijoles. I don't know about you, but I can think of no better way to spend an afternoon. To eat beans. Comer frijoles is pleasing to me. Me gusta comer frijoles. Jugar tenis. O jugar al tenis. Is also pleasing to me. Me gusta jugar al tenis. So, whatever it is that you like to do, whatever activity you like to do, you start with me gusta, and then you use what we call, again, the infinitive form of the verb. To play tennis pleases me. To eat beans pleases me, and does other things. Me gusta comer frijoles. Me gusta jugar al tenis. See? Me gusta estudiar español. Excelente. So whatever the activity is, we have el infinitivo, and we have the form of the verb gustar. In this case, me gusta because it's what I like to do. So if I want to ask someone else what he or she likes to do, or if he or she likes to play tennis, and they're a friend of mine, or they're an informal person, te gusta jugar al tenis? Te gusta jugar al tenis? Sí, te gusta mucho. Me gusta mucho. Me gusta, te gusta. Bien, if I'm talking about a third person, my brother, my sister, I have to use this thing here called the personal I. Let's say my brother likes to play tennis. A mi hermano, I use le gusta. Me gusta jugar al tenis. Okay, muy bien. So, we're talking about ourselves. Me gusta. Me gusta comer donuts. Homer Simpson. Le gusta comer donuts. Le gusta. When I go out with Homer to the Dunkin' Donuts, I say, a Homer y a mí nos gusta comer donuts. ¿Sí? Muy bien. Because we like to do it. Bien. If other people like to do something, what if you have more than one brother or sister? A mis hermanos. Remember, mis has to match hermanos. A mis hermanos les gusta viajar a Europa. They like to travel to Europe. Les gusta trabajar en la casa. Les gusta textear a sus amigos, etc., etc., etc. So, talking about yourself, me gusta. Asking someone else, te gusta? Me gusta for usted. A mi hermano me gusta. Nos gusta, because it's what we like to do. Les gusta, what they like to do. Now, this is a totally different set of rules that we have with our other verbs. Remember, comer, hablar, vivir, etc. It's done in a different way. The subject is not here. Subject is what you like to do. So if you like to study, estudiar me gusta. Me gusta estudiar. To study pleases me. Me gusta estudiar. Muy bien. Ejercicio 9. Ejercicio 9. We have the maestra, number 1, maestra y Ernestito. The teacher is asking Ernestito, do you like to ride your bike? She's asking Ernestito, she's going to use this one. ¿Te gusta andar en bicicleta? Which Ernestito will reply, of course, sí. Me gusta mucho. ¿Te gusta? Sí, me gusta. Muy bien. Ejercicio 10. You're given a series of pictures. We have Ernestito eating a cheeseburger. And so we have a Ernestito. Again, that's your personal a, has to do with the person's name. A Ernestito blank gusta blank. Because a Ernestito, talking about him, it's going to be le gusta, in this case, to eat, comer. Le gusta comer hamburguesas. Muy bien. Actividad, ejercicio 9, ejercicio 10. Adiós.